Thus far, we have looked at teach my hands to war, that it's something we learn, that we learn how to engage the enemy. And we've looked at knowing your enemy, knowing who your adversary is, knowing how he attacks, how he works, knowing his structure within the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of Satan, and then knowing satanic strategies, how he attacks us, when he attacks us, areas that he attacks us. And then we looked last week also about where the battleground is. The real battle is most of the time in our minds. Even though sometimes it's a physical battle, most of the time the battle is in our minds. But tonight we're going to examine and dive deeper into what spiritual warfare is really all about. What it's really all about. Because the devil, even though he may put sickness upon you, there's always a hidden agenda behind it. Even though there might be hard times financially, there is an ulterior motive behind his attack. Always, he's always after one thing, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. What is that one thing? And I'm just going to get right into it. You guys ready? You got your notes? You ready to take notes? Praise God. We need to pray this sickness off of our church that's been hitting people. We've got people not here tonight because they're sick. Jason, Christina, Uriah, they're all sick. And we're just going to pray God bring supernatural health to our church during this sick season. Amen. Let's pray before we get into the word. Father, I thank you tonight for your presence. I feel you in this place. You're the disciple maker, Jesus. You're the one that teaches us how to grow in you, to be more like you, to be disciplined in spiritual areas. God, I pray tonight as we endeavor to divide the word of truth, I pray tonight for your grace and your blessings and your favor and your anointing. God, I pray that the seed of your word would fall upon the good, fertile soil of our hearts. Let it take deep root and spring up unto life everlasting. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. So tonight we're going to talk about the fight for my faith. The fight of faith. So there's three things. Actually, there's probably about four things. But number one, let's just go and we'll see here how many we do. Number one, first off, it is a fight for my faith. Why does the devil attack me? And the devil, and we've talked about all the areas he attacks, and we're not going to go back into all those things, making me feel lonely, isolated, depressed, discouraged, attacking me financially, attacking me physically with sickness, using my kids, amen, to get on my nerves, amen. That Sunday morning argument that seems to happen every week, all those things, what is it all about? Well, the Bible says the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. So, what is the one thing that gives us eternal life? Your faith in God. So, what is the devil ultimately trying to steal, kill, and destroy? The thing that gave you eternal life, your faith in God. It is a fight for your faith, and every attack of the enemy upon your life is an attack to get you to disbelieve what God says and to believe what he says. It's always an attack of faith. Whenever you're discouraged, you know what it is. And I said this a couple of weeks ago. Discouragement is believing the devil instead of believing what God said. It is an attack on faith. You look in the Garden of Eden, whenever the serpent beguiled Eve, the serpent first said, you shall not surely die. He contradicted what God said and tried to bring doubt upon what God said and tried to convince her of something else. It was an attack of faith. You see, the Bible says that whatever is not of faith is sin. You know why people sin? Because they don't believe. Unbelief always produces sin. Unbelief always. Why did Adam and Eve take of that fruit? Because they didn't believe what God's word really said. They believed the lie of the devil instead of believing God. And so Jesus said that when the Holy Ghost has come, he will reprove the world of sin, righteousness, of judgment. And then he said, of sin, because they believe not on me. Why is he convicting of us of sin? Because of our unbelief. Unbelief produces sin. So the devil wants to get unbelief in your life. He wants to attack your life. Or attack your faith life, because if he knows if he can attack your faith, he will weaken you in all areas of your spiritual walk. Amen? So that's why the Bible talks about the trial of your faith being much more precious than that of gold. The trial of your faith. Amen? Think it not strange concerning the fiery trial that awaits you. as some strange thing. Well, you know what it's all about? It's about faith. And we're going to get to all that in just a minute. But first of all, number one, it is a fight for my faith. That's what it's really about. So you just know that. If you get sick and you recognize the devil's fighting you with sickness, you know why he's trying to do that? He's trying to get your faith down. Because with sickness, with disease, with all of those things comes a faith that it pulls your faith down, right? It keeps you out of church, right? The devil don't want you to get here. If you could be sick any day of the week, he's going to try to make you sick on Sunday to keep you from getting in God's house, because he knows faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. You're going to hear the word, faith's going to increase, and that's the last thing he wants. Amen? So it's a fight for your faith. Number two. It is a fight with my faith. How do I fight the devil? I fight him with my faith. Isn't that ironic? He's fighting me for my faith. That's what he's after. But the way I retaliate is fight back with my faith. Isn't that ironic? In 1 John 5 and 4, here's what the Word of God says. In 1 John 5 and 4, let's see if our computer genius can get it on here. She's trying to figure it out tonight. There she goes. Look at what it says in 1 John 5 and 4. Whatever or whatsoever or whosoever is born of God overcomes the world. That means if you've been born again, you have the power to overcome the world. You have the power to overcome sin. Amen. Don't tell me you have to sin a little bit every day, that there's a sin in your life you can't help doing. You have a power inside of you to overcome it. And look at what it says that power is. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. So how do we fight the devil? What is it that propels us to victory? It is our faith. Amen? So in 1 Timothy 6 and 12, Paul says this. Fight the good fight of faith. I know I said it Sunday night. He didn't say it was an easy fight. He said it was a good fight. Amen. But notice what kind of fight it is. It's a fight for my faith, but it's a fight with my faith as well. So I fight the good fight of faith with my faith, and I lay hold onto eternal life, whereunto you are called and have professed a good profession before many witnesses. So no, it's a fight of faith. It's a fight for your faith, and it's a fight with your faith. Jude chapter 1, verse 3, it says this. He tells us to earnestly contend for the faith. It is a contention, a war. For what? The faith. The faith. In Exodus 14 and 13, notice what it says here. Moses said unto the people, fear ye not. This is when the Egyptians are closing in behind them, and Israel's out in the middle of nowhere. They've got nowhere to go but the Red Sea on one side, the Pharaoh's army behind them, and they don't know what to do. But Moses said unto the people, fear not, stand still. Everybody say, stand still. We're going to talk about that in just a minute, but no, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show you today. For the Egyptians whom you've seen today, you will see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. So what was they supposed to do? Were they supposed to pull out swords? Was they supposed to pull out weapons? No. They were supposed to stand still in faith. Believe what God's word said. Believe the man of God who had heard the word of God, and stand on the word. And can you imagine every second that passes, those horses are getting closer. Those men with those swords and those spears are getting closer and closer. And you know what? There is a temptation to say, we got to do something. We got to run, we got to try to swim. But there, that's when the fight was. You see, the fight with them was not with them picking up actual swords. The fight was a fight of faith to trust what God's word had said, that I will not run, I will not cower away in fear, and I will not resort to physical weapons, because the weapons of my warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. So I'm going to stand still, and I'm going to believe what God's word said, and watch God fight my battle for me. Even your weapons are provided because of your faith. Now, we're going to talk about weapons in the couple of weeks to come. the weapons of our warfare that God has given us. But real quickly, know this. It doesn't do you any good to have spiritual weapons if you don't have faith. Look at this. The loin belt of truth. What good is truth if you don't believe it? The breastplate of righteousness. How does righteousness come? It's imparted to you by faith. Not by works, but by faith. Shoes of peace. The gospel of peace. Shoes that bring the gospel of peace. It's a bringing a message of grace that is received not by works, but through faith. One of the weapons of our warfare is even called a shield of faith. Then there's the helmet of salvation. How was you saved? You was saved by faith. Then there's the sword of the Spirit. What good is the Bible if I don't believe the Bible? I gotta have faith in this word. Somebody say amen. Then there's prayer. Prayer is one of your spiritual weapons that Paul lists in Ephesians 6. But what good does it do me to ask God for something if I don't have faith that he's going to do it? If I ask and I believe not, I'm wasting my time. So I believe that I receive when I pray, and that brings spiritual weapons. You see, it is a fight with my faith. Whatever the weapon that I use, whether defensive or offensive, it is a fight with my faith. And I said this a couple of weeks ago, but some of us, we've got to realize and we got to start fighting. Don't fight for your victory. You've got to fight from the perspective of your victory. Don't fight for victory. Fight from victory. Because victory is already won. The moment God decreed the word, if you will stand still, Israel, you'll see my salvation. Victory was already assured them. Never before has God ever told a lie, and he's not going to start now just because Israel, on Israel's behalf. Israel wasn't that special to make God out to be a liar. God said, I've always been faithful. I'll always be faithful. If you will do what I said, I will promise you I'll do what I said I would do. So the fight was stand still and see. Victory is already promised you, so don't fight for your victory. Just stand back and fight from the perspective of victory. Amen? In Colossians 2 and 13, I know I've used this verse, and I hope that I use it so much you memorize it. I used it Sunday morning, I believe. And I think I probably used it a couple times already in this series. But in Colossians 2 and 13, look at what it says. You being dead in your sins, and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened or made alive. The word quickened simply means to make alive. He made you alive together with him. Having forgiven you all trespasses. Isn't that a wonderful blessing? Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us. He took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Now look at this next verse. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. So the key to Satan's defeat is wrapped up in the fact that you have to know this. It is already done. The key to the devil's defeat in your life is wrapped up in the fact you have to first come to grips that he is already defeated. He will never be defeated as long as you're trying to fight him. You can't fight the devil and win. He's bigger than you. He's badder than you without the power of the Holy Ghost. But there was. The Bible, Jesus even told a parable. How can one enter into a strong man's house and bind him except first a stronger than he come into his house and bind him, and then he will bind him and spoil his goods. Well, can I tell you, the devil was a strong man, but there was a stronger man that came to this earth, went to a cross, hung on Calvary, and spoiled his goods. And he is bound. He has no authority in your life. You don't need to fight for your victory. You need to fight from the perspective that it is finished. I am a victor, not because of what I've done, but because of what he done. I stand in faith. What he did was enough. Having spoiled principalities. That literally means that he disarmed the powers and disarmed the authorities of Satan's whole kingdom. And he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing. Look at this. He triumphed over them through his cross. You know what a triumph is? A triumph, most of the time, it's not actually just winning the victory, but it's followed by a celebration and a demonstration of the victory. Think about it. Right? You know what happens whenever you win the football game? You throw a party, right? You know when they win the World Series? When they win the, what's that other one in football? Super Bowl? You know the one everybody misses church for? They throw a party. If that game was in the opposing city and they won, when they come back home, when they arrive, when that plane lands, there are people by the thousands awaiting to cheer for them, waiting to praise their heroes. Come on, somebody, help me. That is a triumph. That is a triumphal entry. And the Bible tells us that Jesus triumphed over the devil. Look at this verse, another verse of Scripture in 2 Corinthians 2 and 14. It says, "Thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ." How often does he do it? I got a pastor friend that before we used to go to his church at Rudy, Arkansas, while we was DYDs, and he used to tell us this. One of the verses, he would do this quite often, but this was a verse, we stayed on it for about 6 months there, that he would say this verse and have everybody say this verse. "Now thanks be unto God," you say it with me, let's just pretend we're them, all right, say it with me. "Now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place." Then he would say it like this. When?
Always.
When?
Always.
When?
Always.
Where? Come on, you're getting it. Where? Where? So when do you triumph? Where? When? Come on, somebody, get it. I'm not going to be defeated. I'm going to be victorious on my job. I can walk in victory at my school. I can walk in victory when the boss man hands me a notice and says, "There's no more work for you." Thanks be unto God, I'm walking out in triumph. Hallelujah. When they curse me and say, "We don't want you here," I'll shake the dust off my feet and walk up, and I'm going to leave with victory in my life. Hallelujah. Somebody give the Lord a hand clap of praise. He always leads us in his triumph. Think about it. Back in ancient days, whenever they would go to war, the king would come back into town riding out in front of the army. And behind him was his army. And they were standing head with their heads up high. And people had gathered in their streets, and they were cheering on the king. You remember whenever David came back to town and Saul came back to town, they were cheering on David, and they were cheering on Saul. They got a problem there, and they're not going to get into all that. But to give an illustration, there was a triumph procession that went. Well, can I tell you today, soon and very soon, there's going to be a triumphal procession. Oh, hallelujah. Thanks be to God, which always leads us through a triumphal procession. Whatever I go through, I'm coming out in victory. Hallelujah. 1 John 3 and 8. Let's move on. 1 John 3 and 8. Ain't that just shouting, and then you look at this one. "He that commits sin is of the devil." Shout now. He that commits sin. Now what does that mean? Does that mean, and this isn't really have anything to do with our message tonight, but does that mean somebody's possessed of the devil? Does that mean somebody's oppressed? What it means is this, that they are born of the devil. In other words, they're born under his slavery, under his dominion. They're his. When you see "of the devil," it means, "of" means possession. The love of God. It's God's love. He that commits sin is of the devil, possessed by the devil. And possessed in the sense of not demonic possession, but possessed in the sense that he owns them. But look at this, "For the devil sinneth from the beginning. But for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested." This is why he came. that he might destroy the works of the devil. Because I can look at the first part of that verse and I can immediately start thinking, well, there's that person, there's that person. But if we start thinking, here it is, I was that person. I was of the devil. My mama even told me, I'm just playing. She's probably watching on live stream saying, I'm going to wring your neck, boy. No, I belonged to the devil. I was a servant to the devil. Amen. I was a slave to the devil. But this is why Jesus came, so that I can have a change of ownership and that he would destroy the works of the devil. The word destroy is a Greek word that means to untie or to loose something. In other words, Jesus came to untie and to loose Satan's binding power over me, so that he don't have control over me. He doesn't have dominion over me any longer. I don't belong to him. So when he tries to put something upon me, I gotta recognize what he's trying to do is he's trying to deceive me. He has no legal rights. He has no legal authority. I've been bought with the blood of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. I'm a property of the King. So if he's trying to put something on me, discouragement, depression, jealousy, anger, bitterness, poverty, whatever it is, I got to realize that the blessings of the Lord maketh rich and addeth no sorrow, that I'm more than a conqueror through him that gave himself for me and loved me, and I refuse to accept that, and I rebuke the devil in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You know where all that comes in at? It's a fight with my faith. You've got to believe what God's word said. Because the devil's going to want you to believe, well, I've still got this area in your life, well, I still have control over. The Bible says if you have given your life to him, the works of the devil are being destroyed in your life. He has no authority. His weapons have been spoiled through the cross. So why am I still walking in defeat? Because you don't believe what God's word said. It's doubt. It's doubt. Victory comes through faith. This is the victory that overcometh the world, our faith. Well, I'm not praying enough. No, that's legalism. I'm not reading the Bible. No, that's legalism. You see, it's nothing you do to overcome. It's everything he did for you to overcome. And you put your faith in not what I can do to overcome, but what he did for me so that I can walk in victory. Hallelujah. It's a fight of faith. Number three. Here's what faith is. And I know we would all say faith is the substance of things hoped for and it's the evidence of things not seen. And that it is. But here's really what faith is. Faith is the ability to stand. That's number three. Faith is the ability to stand. If you enter into this thing trying to win the battle that's already been won by Jesus, then it becomes a form of self-righteousness. So your approach must be of one standing in the victory that Christ has already won for you. I said this a while ago, but you can't defeat the devil. There are some Christians that try to defeat the devil. That's a form of pride, that I'm bigger and I'm badder. God doesn't need you to defeat the devil because he's already been defeated. Who defeated him? Jesus did. And what did Jesus do? He gave you to be a partaker of that victory that he won at the cross. So what is faith? It's my ability to stand in the victory that he already won for me, regardless of the lies that the devil tells me. You see, Jesus already took stripes upon my back, but the devil's going to tell me, you're sick, you're going to die of that, but what do I have to do? I fight by standing. I fight by doing nothing but standing in what he did for me, standing and believing that by his stripes I was healed. Hallelujah. Man, I feel the Holy Ghost. So your part is simply to believe and to stand in victory. That's why we find that same word stand repeated four times in Ephesians 6. Ephesians 6 and 11, here's what it says. It says, stand against the wiles of the devil. Did y'all get that? Stand against the wiles of the devil. Verse 13 says that you would withstand in that evil day. And having done all to stand. The next verse says, stand therefore. What is this whole battle about? It's about me learning how to stand. So when you're taking part in spiritual warfare, you're going to be the one that's left standing. When I was a kid, I remember we used to watch Rawhide. Y'all remember that show? Rolling, rolling, rolling. Now I think about it, and I think about the Blues Brothers, you know, trying to redo it. I remember we used to watch Gunsmoke and all those good stuff. And I remember, now Gunsmoke, I got to be honest, Charles talks about him being weird, and I hate to admit it, I was pretty weird too as a kid. But I grew out of that weirdness, praise God. Now it's Charles, only now. But I told my wife this, and she laughed so hard at me. Somehow I got a hold of a real gun belt, like a Western, you know, that type thing. And I mean, it was so cool. And I wore that thing, you know, it was two of them. I'd strap it to my legs, and I tied ropes on my bicycle and pretended it was a horse. And I rode all up and down that dead end street pretending I was Marshall Dillon looking for somebody. Yeah, come on. Aren't you thankful I grew out of that weirdness? So what happened, I remember in those shows, though, Marshall Dillon would come out, and there'd be this dude out there thinking he could take him on, right? Now, not anybody could do this. Not anybody could try what Marshall Dillon was about to try, because not everybody had the authority Marshall Dillon had. Or the height. And there's a whole message in that, because when you try to take on the devil in your own strength, you're out of a line. You're out of authority. That badge represents authority. Jesus said, I give you authority. I give you authority. And that gun represents power. You will receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Some people got authority, but they ain't got no power. Back it up. You need both. You need authority in Jesus' name, and you need the baptism of the Holy Ghost to have power to back it up. Amen? But notice this. I don't know how I'm getting off on all that. I got to hurry. These guys would get out in the street, and they would come walking. I thought all cowboys walked that way, you know. They walked that way. Jessica, don't be Snapchatting me. They walked that way. Because they've been riding those horses all day. Yeah. All right, I'm going to stop. My wife's making me cut that out of that live stream. But they get out there and they get like this, right? And then. Right? Come on. And then the next thing you know, they're both standing there and all of a sudden one of them starts to fall. And for a minute, you wonder, who won that thing? Well, we always knew the guy with the white hat was going to win, right? We always knew that was the way it was. But how did we know? There was that moment of tension, but the one left standing walked away the winner. Well, can I tell you, when you do warfare God's way, you will always be the one left standing. Through hell, through high water, whatever you go through, whatever the devil throws at you, whether it's a bankruptcy, whether it's a divorce, whether it's the death of your children, if you will stand in faith, come on somebody, if you will stand when it's all said and done, weeping may endure for the night, but joy cometh in the morning, I will stand with my, Job said, I know my Redeemer liveth, and one day I will stand with him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Until then, the Bible says this in 2 Timothy 2 and 3. We're going to have to endure hardness as a good soldier. I said it. It's not an easy fight. It's a good fight, and it's going to require some hardness. Paul said in 2 Timothy 4 and 7, I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I kept the faith. Get that. A good fight. How did he fight the good fight? How did he finish his course? He kept the faith. It's a fight of faith. So in James 1 and 2, James says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, when you go into trials, tribulations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. If you want to build muscle, you know what you have to do? Get off the couch. But that's not all. If you want to build muscle, most of the time just walking around won't build muscle. People that want to lose weight, you know what they do? They walk the street. They get on a treadmill. That's what they do. They lose weight, but that doesn't always build muscle. It might build a little bit, but if you want to get big and strong, you know what you got to do? You got to have some resistance. Come on, somebody. Not just natural resistance of gravity, but I've got to have more than that. I've got to come up against something that's really challenging for me to get to where I need. Come on, somebody. To get to the next level, to get to the next step, I'm going to have to fight some devils. You see, could it be that some of the things you're going through, the reason God is allowing it because he wants to elevate you to another level of faith, to another realm of the spirit. And for every new level, there's a new devil. When you get to that level, you're going to be able to face new devils. There's things some of you right now are fighting that 5 years ago, you would have never been able to fight. You would have backslid that day when the first day they attacked you. But because God has grown your faith, you're standing in a faith that's growing, a faith that's maturing. Why? Because God knows what you can take. Oh, hallelujah. I said God knows what he can take. And know this, he said, let patience have her perfect work. God's working. God, through the devil fighting you, what he don't realize he's doing, he's growing your faith so that God can show just how bad he is. People will hate you. People will rate you. People will shake you. And then they'll break you. But how strong you stand, that's what makes you. Hallelujah. That's what makes you. Not what they said about you, not what they did to you, but when it's all said and done, I got better instead of bitter. Hallelujah. And number four, and we're going to close after this, I think. You need to fight this fight of faith. Fight with people of like faith. Because you're not in this alone. If you think you can do it by yourself, and I know I'm preaching to the choir tonight. Most of us are here every time the doors are open. Paul warned us not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some people do. And so much more as we get to the coming of the Lord, he said, it's so important that you lean on one another. You need your brothers and sisters in Christ. So in Ephesians 6 and 10, it says this. Finally, my brethren. Everybody say brethren. Now before we read any further, let's look at that. My brother. My brothers, Paul says. It wasn't always common to call people brothers that weren't kin to you. Now, when Patrick showed up, he did that, not me. My brother from another mother. All right, Patrick, let me preach, all right? Finally, my brethren. It wasn't always common to call people brethren. The Greek word for brother means those born from the same womb. This is the same Greek word that normally is used to describe literal brothers, blood brothers. But this word began to carry a different meaning even before Paul wrote this. And really, it had nothing to do with Christians starting using it. It was wicked Greek. The wicked Grecians, Alexander the Great, was the one who started using this word to refer to people that was not blood brothers. What he would do would be after they would conquer, and by the way, Alexander the Great conquered the entire known world by the time he was 33 years of age. And what they would do after they'd win a great battle, Alexander would throw a feast for his soldiers. Before this large audience of people, he would lock arms with individual faithful soldiers, one at a time. and he would publicly declare, "Let all the empire know that Alexander is proud to be the brother of this soldier." So the word brother began to be used as a word, even in Alexander's time, that carried the idea of a comrade or a fellow soldier. Soldiers who were worthy of your association. Those who were in the same fight you're in. There is a special bond with God's people. And it goes beyond what we like, whether we have the same taste, whether we have the same hobbies. There is a bond that we are spiritually born of the same spirit. So we have that bond. But there is another bond in the sense that just like the Marines all stick together. Y'all ever seen Marines? They can be 80 years old, had been in service for 60 years, but once a Marine, always a Marine. Well, can I tell you today that we have that same bond because we are engaged in the same battle. We're engaging the same enemy. We're engaged in the same warfare. So don't feel alone. Don't feel isolated. You have brothers. I said you have brothers. You have sisters that are fighting that same devil just like you are fighting. That's why Peter writes in 1 Peter 5 and 8 to be sober, to be vigilant, because your adversary, the adversary as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. But look at verse 9. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brothers that are in the world. So what he's saying is while we're engaging the enemy, we got to know that we're fighting the fight with people. We've locked arms with somebody. Somebody's got my back. Somebody's praying for me. I'm not alone in the fight. I've got a pastor that's there for me. I've got so-and-so that sits on that pew, and she don't say much, but I know she's a prayer. Well, come on, somebody. She's a praying lady, and if I need her, I can pick up the phone and say, "Hey, would you pray for me?" And she knows how to get a hold of heaven. There is an importance that you have brothers in the Lord. Because you can't win this fight by yourself. I talked about my Westerns a while ago. I used to watch Lone Ranger. Y'all ever seen people that thought they could do it all by themselves? I ain't got to go to church. I ain't got to have any Christian friends. How can you love the head and not love the body? How can you love Jesus and not love his church? Amen. Jesus loved the church. That means if you have the same desires he had, you'll love what he loved. If you want to be like him, like Christ, the Bible says, as his custom was, he went to the house of God on the Sabbath day. Oh, let me get back to Tonto and Lone Ranger. Even the Lone Ranger had Tonto. He did. Even the Lone Ranger had Tonto. He had somebody there with him. You need somebody. And there is the importance in a unity in an army. As the body of Christ, we have to have unity. We have to have unity. We have to have the same focus. We have to have the same mission. We have to, come on, because the devil wants nothing less than to get us divided. He wants nothing less. You know, an army that's fighting amongst themselves, the devil ain't got to do nothing. Amen. You look at any army, and if they ever start turning on each other, you know what happens? The other folks just step back and say, "Man, we ain't got to swing our sword. They're going to kill one another." That's what the devil wants. So there is an importance that we are in unity. That we don't speak evil one of another. That we pray for one another. That we lift one another up. That we encourage one another. When we see somebody getting discouraged, somebody miss church, it's important that you get on that phone, that you send them a text, whatever, and you encourage them. Amen. All right, let's move on real quick. Finally, my brethren, let's get past that part. Brethren, let's get that scripture back up. Ephesians 6. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. The word strong is a Greek word that means, it's actually two Greek words coming together. It's the word in, E-N, and the word dunamis. I preached about dunamis not long ago. E-N simply means I-N, it means in, in. Dunamis means explosive power, explosive strength. So it means to live in explosive strength or power. It implies a power that is being deposited into something. Just like a vessel or a container, that power is being poured into it. That it is not a one-time thing, but it is a continual thing. That power is continually being poured into it. And the Bible commands us to be strong, that we constantly have to stay in that state of mind, that we constantly have to come to that place where God pours strength into our lives. Come on, somebody, help me preach just a few more minutes. Stay with me. But notice the next part. He says, the phrase in the Lord, that my brethren be strong in the Lord. Everybody say in the Lord. In the Lord is grammatically called the locative tense. And it means that this strength can only be located from one source. And that is, this is a strength that only comes from Jesus Christ. You can't get this strength from anybody else. There's not enough books you can read. There's not enough knowledge to obtain. This is a strength that has to be supernaturally departed by the Lord. So he says, be strong in the Lord. But then he says, be strong in the power of his might. The Greek word for power is a different word. It's the word kratos, which means a demonstrated power. The same Greek word is used in Ephesians 1 and 19, where it talks about how that it's the Spirit of God that raised Christ from the dead by the power of the Holy Ghost. The word power, the kratos power, when he raised Christ from the dead. But notice this. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead, we say it like this, will one day raise our bodies. And that's true. But notice this as well. He says that the same power that raised Jesus from the dead, we can right now be strong in that power. We can right now live in resurrection power. Then he uses another word. He uses the word mighty, or the word might, rather. The word might conveys an extremely strong man, like a bodybuilder. And Paul applies this picture of a strong man, a muscular man. And he's not saying that he's that strong man, but that God is that strong man. God is the one who is able. God is the one who is mighty. God is the one who is muscular. We don't have the strength in ourselves to carry the armor of God. Did you listen to this? You write this down if you got time. The average man, the average size Roman soldier, if you put the armor upon them, the armor that Paul describes in these next few verses, that armor alone weighed 100 pounds. Come on, some of y'all can't even lift 30. You know, they ask you for your job, you got to lift at least 30 pounds. Could you imagine putting on 100 pounds and wearing it all the time? 100 pounds of armor. Now, I could kind of imagine that because I put on about that much over the last. I made it work, you know. But what kind of man would be required to wear that kind of weaponry? And the answer is this, a strong man. A weak person can't wear 100 pounds of armor. Remember when David goes and he's getting ready to go out and fight the giant? And Saul puts all this armor on him? David was just a young boy. He couldn't wear that big armor. So therefore, before Paul goes into any detail about spiritual weapons, he first informs us that God has to first, before we put on anything, God has to provide us with a supernatural power so that we can effectively know how to use the weapons of our warfare to contend with the enemy. So Paul puts first things first. He begins with the text of armor by first dealing with the kratos power of God. I'm closing with this, so just follow me for 2 minutes. Without that power of God, we are no match for our adversary. We cannot function in the armor of God. What good is all the weapons if I'm too weak to stand in them? After all, the battle is standing. Standing in the faith. What good is weapons if I put them all on and I fall down? I don't even have to fall. I mean, I just have all of this religious stuff I'm trying to do and I don't even have the strength to pray. Right? How do I build strength up? I grow. I learn. I teach myself. I come with resistance. Amen? Now let me ask you this. Is there anything more powerful than God? The reason that Kratos' power is so powerful and demonstrative is that God's muscles are backing it up. This is where the key is. He says, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and be strengthened by the power of His might. Where does this strength come from? It's not your strength, it's His strength. Where does this power come from? It's His power. Where does this might come from? It's His might. So I've got to learn to walk in the power of God if I'm going to engage the enemy. And notice what I said, that it's God's muscles that are backing it up. God is the bodybuilder, if you will. And I'm closing with this in Isaiah 52:8. It says, the Lord hath made bare His holy arm in the eyes of all the nations. Come on, get that scripture up there with me. Isaiah 52:8. It says, the Lord hath made bare His holy arm in the eyes of all the nations. You know what that means when it says God made bare His arm? God made bare His arm. It literally means this. God rolled His sleeve up and flexed His muscle in the face of the enemy, and they took off running. Well, can I tell you today, that's all this strength that you need is for God just to flex His muscle, and you're standing behind Him. All you're doing is what? Standing in His strength. It's not my strength, not my power, not my muscles. I'm just putting my faith that greater is He that's in me than he that's in this world. Let's stand together and give the Lord a hand clap of praise today. Praise you, Jesus. Come on, you can do better than that. Let's give Him praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thanks be to God, which always causes us to triumph. Thanks be to God, which always causes us to triumph. Thank you, Jesus. Let's pray. Father, I thank you tonight for your presence. I thank you tonight that we are assured of victory. Victory's already been won. Some of us wear ourselves out from swinging weapons and fighting when all we have to do is stand in the victory you've already won. Lord, in the name of Jesus, I pray that faith would come right now. That we would believe what your word said.